I was a student when I made my first visit to London. It was the summer of 1997. I was poor and on a budget. I came just for the day on a National Express coach from Cambridge. I wasn't easy. Dark thoughts of what skinheads did to black people in Europe entered my mind.
Here you go, darling. Here's your change.
Thanks. I saw Pudding Lane and Westminster Abbey, the Old Bailey, the sparkling dirty Thames, and the many sights and places that I knew from books and television.
People, now, if you would look to your left, you would miss what's on the right. No, just kidding. Now, if you would look to your right, you would see the marble arch. The marble arch is a 19th century white marble faced triumphal arch in London. The structure was designed by John Nash in 1827 to be the state entrance to the Golden Hill of Buckingham Palace. Now, everybody fall in line and we'll take a tour around her, shall we?
I immediately thought of Jeff Buckley's Hallelujah. My best friend David Ottewell had introduced me to his music before. I hopped off the bus and walked into Hyde Park from the Marble Arch entrance. It was a good place as any to eat my sandwich lunch. As I walked into the park, I almost became part of a crowd of Hare Krishna followers. The small, enthusiastic crowd was mainly middle-aged. The men, in white linen trousers and tunics, the women, looking incongruous in clothes from two continents separated by a vast ocean. They wore saris accessorized with colorful woven bags from Latin America. I walked away from the Hare Krishnas and found myself at Speaker's Corner.
Prepare yourselves. The end is soon to be here. All you sinful will be put to hell.
There was a member of the International Socialist Organization speaking.
The Berlin Wall only hinders the freedom of the people in Berlin. It divides Germany into two. While the East is suffering from the communist Soviets, the West is growing fully in economy. Why can't we reunite Germany and let them grow as one?
And there was also a group of students campaigning against a multinational that was forcing infant formula on women in developing countries, making me feel terribly guilty because all I could think of was one of the multinational's famed chocolate bars.
What do we want?
Stop the infant formula.
When do we want?
Right now.
Stop the infant formula.
Stop the infant formula.
Stop the infant formula.
I took that as a prompt to have my late lunch and walked to eat it in the loveliness of Rose Garden. After my meal, I turned right and found myself in Rotten Row. I felt immediately homesick for Zimbabwe. There are not many Rotten Rows in the world, and one of them is in Harare. I have visited Hyde Park many times since then, and have come to love other sites that I missed that day, particularly the moving Holocaust Memorial with its text from the Book of Lamentation that reads, "But the charm of the first visit has never left me." Speaker's Corner speaks to the quality I love most about the British, which was their tolerance for eccentricity. And that day showed me another quality that I love in big city dwellers. Not just the Londoners, but those of other big cities too. Coming from a city in the guise of a village, where to be present is to invite attention and loud comment on your clothes, your hair, your very being, I love that there was an accepted code of behavior about being private in public, and that I could disappear into my own world in the middle of a communal park. I love Hyde Park, also because it reminds me of home. Not only because of Rotten Row, but because it gives me an idea of what my city's planners had in mind when they put the Harare Gardens, my city's largest park, in the middle of the city. As I left the park through Hyde Park Corner that day in 1997, I walked away with an idea in my mind of the kind of place that my city could have become, of the kind of place that Harare still could be when, and if ever, it grows up.
Maybe there's a God above. All I've ever learned from love was how to shoot somebody who I drew.